They came from different lands, all facing an uncertain future. English and Ashanti, Mende and Portuguese, German and Igbo, Fanti and Spaniard, French and Angolan. Some seeking adventure or riches or religious freedom. Others were captives, bartered and sold like cattle. Together they would build a nation and struggle over the very meaning of freedom and create the America we have inherited today.
I don't think you can understand race relations today without understanding slavery. Even though people will say, I didn't do it, my father didn't do it, even my grandparents, they didn't do it. One of the things that's essential is to know that slavery is not just a Southern institution, it's an American institution.
What evolves in North America is the belief system where to be black meant to be a slave, and to be a slave meant to be black. We hold these truths to be self-evident. Why is it self-evident? It came from God. They're inalienable. Government secures them. Remarkable document. Didn't apply to black folks. And the man who wrote them, those words, Thomas Jefferson, kept slaves. He also wrote sometime later to a friend, if there is a just God, we're going to pay for this.
Slavery and freedom existed side by side in this country. I think the issue is, did it always have to be that way? And the early history of America indicates that it probably did not.
About the latter end of August, a Dutch man of war arrived at Point Comfort. The commander's name, Captain Joop. He brought not anything but 20 and odd Negroes, which the governor bought in exchange for food. John Rolfe, Virginia colonist.
In 1619, a year before the Pilgrims landed at Plymouth Rock, a mystery ship appeared out of a violent storm off the Virginia coast. No one recorded the ship's name, but somewhere on the high seas, she had robbed a Spanish vessel of a cargo of Africans. In search of supplies, she traded the Africans for food. They had been baptized and given Christian names. As Christians, they could not be enslaved for life under English law. Like most Europeans in the colony, they were purchased to work as servants for a limited number of years. The English definition of who could be enslaved began to shift from non-Christian to non-white. For Anthony and other Africans in America, the idea of an equal chance in the colonies was now under attack. In 1641, Massachusetts became the first colony on the British American mainland to recognize slavery as a legal institution. Connecticut followed in 1650. Maryland in 1663, New York and New Jersey in 1664. Virginia legally recognized slavery in 1661, and a year later, a Virginia court decided that all children born in the colony would be free or slave according to the condition of the mother. In Virginia, slavery would be defined by race and perpetuated through heredity.
By the mid-1400s, a dark chapter of history would begin to emerge.
very early on, with the expansion of Christianity, the notion was that we, as Europeans, must Christianize and civilize the Africans. Civilize.
Racism came to play a part very early in that they were an inferior people, and they were meant to be slaves.
Africa became a continent under siege. English slaver Captain Richard Drake recorded.
On the seventh morning of the march, we reached the enemy's borders and came in sight of a peaceful village. Here our hunting began.
White slavers rewarded Africans for kidnapping other Africans. Sometimes friends were pitted against friends.
In less than an hour, we had secured about 300 prisoners. The old people and infants were not considered of value and were knocked on the head or stuck with spears as fast as they were brought in. Captain Richard Drake, English slaver.
Collaboration was a way to prosper, even to survive.
African leaders are working with slave traders. People are using the slave trade to create a certain class of people who can be sold.
Across the continent, kidnappings could happen at any time. A mother, a father, a child could suddenly simply disappear. Brutal ambushes took many forms. A single capture, a raid by a well-organized group, an intertribal war where defeat meant enslavement. But they didn't quietly accept their fate. African tradition prepared young men and women in survival, endurance, and warfare as part of their rite of passage.
The resistance began immediately in many instances. We must dispel the notion that the African slaves were resigned and felt helpless. That is simply not the case.
Ultimately, the Africans' training was no match against European firepower.
Mama, Mama, wake up, wake up. Sing, Mama, sing me a song.
A warring nation would often trade its human captives for European trinkets. Cheap goods poured into Africa, replacing the African-made products and the people who made them, systematically destroying the African culture. As Africa continued to be economically torn apart, the European powers continued to prosper. It became big business. The Royal African Company was chartered to represent the commercial interests of the English crown, trading goods for slaves in West Africa and transporting those slaves for sale in the New World.
You have to recognize that the slave trade was really based on power and economics. It was for the benefit both of the Westerners and for some Africans. Wars were perpetuated, tribal wars, because of the slave trade. Those in power were the ones that captured and sold slaves. And in doing this, they disrupted the family. One of the most tragic things about the slave trade is what it did to the family.
Stop! Ugly, hateful men! Stop! My father is coming! Oh, cruel ones! Please don't take me. See, I'll be good.
When the grown people were gone far in the fields to labor, the children generally assembled together to play. And some of us often used to get up into a tree to look out for any assailant or kidnapper that might come upon us. One day, when only I and my sister were left to mind the house, two men and a woman got over our walls and in a moment seized us both without giving us time to cry out or to make any resistance. They stopped our mouths and ran off with us. O lauda equiano.
For more than four centuries, people disappeared from the savannas, the rainforests, and the villages of Black Africa. Farmers and craftspeople, commoners and African nobility. Most were strong young men, age 15 to 25. But women and children were also taken and sold. To obtain slaves, Africans waged war, destroying communities, stealing people. To escape the spreading violence, many moved into the interior, abandoning family compounds, farms, entire villages. In West Africa, more than 20 million people were kidnapped into slavery. Only half would survive the journey to the coast.
They were chained. So a device was placed around their neck, so if they escaped in the jungle, they'd get tangled up. They were marched overland to the coast, just simply by force.
After being captured, stolen from their homes and communities, Africans were forced to travel from the interior of Africa to the West Coast. The journey could cover 500 miles and take up to 8 months.
Slaves are commonly secured by putting the right leg of one and the left of another into the same pair of fetters. By supporting the fetters with a string, they can walk, though very slowly. Every four slaves are likewise fastened together by the necks with a strong rope or twisted thongs, and in the night an additional pair of fetters is put on their hands, and sometimes a light iron chain passed around their necks. Mungo Park, British explorer.
Coming down from the interior to the coast, I mean, nobody's made any provisions for food or for the comfort of these people. People who are unable to make the journey, who get sick or become weak and unable to move on, are left to die.
While I was with his enemies in the camp, I saw a child of about 18 months old cast out of the camp because the child was so young that nobody would buy him. That poor orphan was there crying at the point of death for about 2 days, and none took pity to pick him up. Joseph Wright, former African captive.
No matter what happens, they are certainly ill-treated physically, they're certainly ill-treated psychologically and so forth, because they're taken from their homes, taken to a place they know not where. They don't have a clue as to what is going to happen to them. And they have all these images that must have been going through their minds about being eaten, perhaps, or whatever else may happen to them. And so these are things that are immeasurable. You cannot tell how bad this treatment is.
The boy Equiano was one of the survivors.
At last, I came to the banks of a large river. I was beyond measure, surprised at this, as I had never before seen any water larger than a pond or rivulet. And my surprise was mingled with no small fear when I was put into one of these canoes and we began to paddle and move along the river.
On the journey to the coast, Equiano passed from one African master to another. Once he was sold for 172 cowrie shells. He learned three different languages, traveled some 800 miles, and encountered people and customs unfamiliar and frightening to him. After close to 7 months of travel on foot and by boat, he reached the African coast.
The first object that saluted my eyes when I arrived on the coast was the sea and a slave ship, which was then riding at anchor and waiting for its cargo. These filled me with astonishment, but was soon converted into terror. O lauda equiam.
It was an ancient business, this trade in human beings between Africa and Europe. Fifty years before Columbus sailed to the New World, Portuguese explorers had sailed to West Africa. At first seeking gold, they built a fort in 1482 and called it El Mina, the mine. The Portuguese pointed their guns toward the Atlantic to guard, not against Africans, but against European competitors. Over time, the castle changed hands from the Portuguese to the Dutch, and finally the British. And the trade changed from gold to human beings.
Concerning the trade on this coast, we notified Your Highness already that it has completely changed into a slave coast, and that nowadays the natives no longer occupy themselves with the search for gold, but rather make war on each other in order to furnish slaves. The Gold Coast has changed into a complete slave coast. Willem de la Palma, Director, Dutch West India Company.
Along the west coast of Africa, from Senegal in the north to the Cameroons in the south, the Europeans built some 60 forts and castles, warehouses for European merchandise and for African slaves. Called factories, they were commercial centers where agents or factors traded rum, cloth, and guns for human beings and gold.
These large fortresses were built into the cliffs and served as living quarters for the European traders and government officials, and temporary prisons for millions of Africans. Some still stand along the coast of what is now Ghana, Nigeria, the Ivory Coast, Benin, Togo, and Gambia. Today, they're known as points of no return.
The loggins and apartments within the castle are very large and well built of brick, a massive airless dungeon. It will conveniently contain 1,000 blacks. The keeping of the slaves thus underground is a good security against any insurrection. Jean Barbeau, slaver.
I took my son, who was 5 years old, to one of the slave castles. And I wanted to take him into one of the dungeons. And he refused to go in. It looked so terrible to him. But I wanted him to see that. Looking at this dungeon, the darkness, the smelly place, it's like, where did the slaves sleep? Where did they go to the bathroom? How long did they stay here? Why were they sold? Why did they do this to them? They're relevant questions that only a child can ask.
Will they leave me in this fearful place forever? I will not stay here. I will not. The smell is bad, and it is too dark.
The most notable item is the slave house, which lies below ground. It consists of vaulted cellars divided into several apartments which can easily hold 1,000 slaves. Captain John Barbeau, French slave trader.
In dungeons built deep into the ocean rock, people waited. Sometimes a day, sometimes a year. These chambers would be their last memory of Africa. When a slave ship arrived and anchored off the coast, they would be led out from the darkness to the beach.
As the slaves come down to feeder from the inland country, they are put into a booth or prison near the beach. When the Europeans are to receive them, they are brought out into a large plain where the surgeons examine every one of them, all stark naked. Each which have passed as good is marked on the breast with a red-hot iron imprinting the mark of the French, English, or Dutch companies. In this, particular care is taken that the women, as tenderest, be not burnt too hard. Captain John Barbeau, French slave trader.
The white people did not need to be present in the interior of Africa. All they needed to do was to supply the weapons. The people they dealt with were those coastal peoples right on the coastline who controlled the territory down there. So Kwana would not have met, maybe not even heard, of white people.
They weren't loaded directly onto the ship. There were factories on the coast. The Africans were sold to these people, and then they sold them to the ships. And this was an economic enterprise.
How could a situation be created whereby a small group of Europeans could enslave so many Africans in those horrendous conditions?
They succeeded by having greater firepower, military power. They succeeded also by their having a drive to conquer the rest of the world.
I have found no place where I can enlarge my fortune so soon as where I now live. In this manner, we spend the prime of youth among Negroes, scraping the world for money, the universal god of mankind, until death overtakes us. Nicholas Owen, slave trader.
The African trade is a trade of the most advantage to this kingdom of any we derive, and as it were all profit, it is indeed the best traffic the kingdom hath, as it doth occasionally give so vast an employment to our people, both by sea and land. John Carey, Bristol, England.
In 1698, the English Parliament ended the monopoly of the Royal African Company on the African slave trade. It became the right of every freeborn British subject to trade in slaves. Over the next half century, the number of Africans transported to the British colonies in British ships increased from 5,000 to 45,000 a year. England became the largest trafficker in slaves in the Western world.
The first objects which saluted my eyes when I arrived on the coast were the sea and the slave ship, which was then riding at anchor and awaiting its cargo. These filled me with astonishment, which was soon converted into terror when I was carried on board. I was immediately handled and tossed up to see if I was sound by some of the crew. And I was now persuaded that I had gotten into a world of bad spirits, and that they were going to kill me. Their complexions differed so much from ours, their long hair and the language they spoke, which was very different from any I had ever heard, united to confirm me in this belief. As well as the multitude of black people of every description chained together, every one of their countenances expressing dejection and sorrow. No, I no longer doubted my fate, and quite overpowered with horror and anguish, I fell motionless on the deck and fainted. When I recovered a little, I found some black people about me, who I believed were some of those who brought me on board. They were receiving their pay. I now saw myself deprived of all chance of returning to my native country, or even the least glimpse of hope of gaining its shore. But I was not long suffered to indulge my grief, for I was soon put down under the decks. There I received such a salutation in my nostrils as I had never experienced in my life. The stench. The closeness of the place, the heat of the climate, the number of us forced to live in those conditions with scarcely room to turn almost suffocated us. I was soon reduced so low that happily for myself it was thought necessary to keep me always on deck. And because of my extreme youth, I was not put in chains. One day, when we had a smooth sea and moderate wind, two of my wearied countrymen, who were chained together, preferring death to such a life of misery, jumped into the sea. Immediately, another quite dejected fella also followed their example. There was such a noise and confusion amongst the white people to go after the slaves. Two of the wretches were already drowned, but they did get the other, and afterwards flogged him unmercifully for thus attempting to prefer death to slavery. In this manner, we continued to undergo more hardships than I now can or want to relate. Hardships inseparable from this accursed trade that caused, still causes so many of us to prefer death to slavery. Death to slavery.
One day, the white men arrived in ships with wings, which shone in the sun like knives. From that day, the whites brought us nothing but wars and miseries. Oral history from Pende tribe.
Most of the Africans who were brought from the interior had not seen white men until they reached there, and they were afraid of white men. And for some reason, they seemed, most of them, to get the idea that the white man was a cannibal, and they were taken to be killed and eaten.
The blacks were all stripped naked and shipped by twos and threes in canoes through the surf. They are so willful and loath to leave their own country that they have often leaped out of the canoes, boat, and ship into the sea and kept underwater till they were drowned to avoid being taken up and saved by our boats, which pursued them. Thomas Phillips, slave ship captain.
As the ships departed, the Africans saw the sun rising east over their homeland for the last time.
This is a place that is taking away people. So it strikes terror in you. It's not just the physical slave trade, it's the terror that people feel when they see the approach of these vessels. So there's tremendous fear as to what these ships represent.
The Europeans made more than 54,000 voyages to trade in human beings. No one will ever know the exact number of people taken from the shores of West Africa, but more than 11 million have been counted in the records that remain. Most headed for South America and the Caribbean islands, some 500,000 to the mainland of North America. Captains call the voyage from West Africa to the New World the Middle Passage, the middle leg of a triangular course that began and ended in Europe. From English ports, ships sailed to Africa to trade goods for slaves. Then the human cargo was taken to the Americas and traded for raw materials, which were then carried back to England and sold. The crossing from Africa to the Americas usually took 60 to 90 days, but some voyages took as long as 4 or even 6 months. Bad weather and sickness could turn any trip into a nightmare.
The cramped quarters of ships being packed in such a way that a slave will be between the legs of another slave and having to lie in the feces. The lack of air, the longer this trip takes, the more suffocating.
The surgeon, upon going between decks in the morning to examine the situation of the slaves, frequently finds several dead. And sometimes a dead and living Negro fastened by their irons together. When this is the case, they are brought upon the deck. The living Negro is disengaged and the dead one thrown overboard. Alexander Falconbridge, ship's surgeon.
There are no doubt people who went mad. Inability to communicate, decisions having to be made, and this person is suffering as yourself. Does one help? Does one simply try to make it the best that one can alone? Not knowing, where am I being taken? What is my fate? For weeks, months, depending what the point of origin was.
The shrieks of the women and the groans of the dying rendered the whole scene of horror almost inconceivable. Olauda Ebiano, former African captain.
I cannot see my home, my country. Where did they take my people? Who will take care of me down there?
To meet the demand of having to transport human cargo, ships had to be redesigned. Tight packers held up to 1,000 captives, seated below deck with no space between them. Loose packers carried approximately 250 captives, locked in a prone position, arranged on wooden racks 6 feet long and 1 foot wide. The average length of the journey was 8 weeks.
We heard the moans, cries, and rumblings coming from below. And as soon as the captain and crew were removed, the hatches had been taken off, when there arose a hot blast, sickening and overpowering. In the hold were 300 or 400 human beings, gasping and struggling for breath. Some were stiffened in the most unnatural positions. J. Taylor Wood, Anti-Slavery Squadron.
Early slave ships did not provide ventilation for the crowded conditions below.
If you look at some of the surgeons who worked on some of these slave ships, they'll tell you how hot it got in some of these slave holds, that sometimes the candles that the surgeons used to see in the holds often would not burn because there was not enough oxygen.
It is an unbearable situation. And when you speak about it, even the visual doesn't do it. You've got to get the smell.
The slave ships had names like Brotherhood, John the Baptist, Justice and Integrity, Gift of God, Liberty, and Jesus. The crews came from around the world, men and boys.
These people were scared to death. They were stripped of dignity and stripped physically and put on board ship. They didn't know where they were going, what their future was going to be. They were treated like animals, really like animals. They were a product, a piece of merchandise.
You hear stories, of course, of women who took their babies and threw them across the heads of other enslaved people to get to the food and to the trough where they were fed, sometimes like hogs in a trough. And they would throw the babies over the heads of the other people, you know, just so the babies could get something to eat.
Don't they have food in the place of bad spirits? When will we eat? I wish I could dip into my mother's rice pot. Look, is that Mama? Mama, please. Give me some food.
It was his captain's general practice on the receipt of a woman slave, especially a young one, to send for her to come to his cabin so that he might lie with her. Sometimes they would refuse to comply with his desires and would be severely beaten by him and sent below. Surgeon of the Ruby.
Down my cheeks the tears are dripping. Broken is my heart with grief. Mangled my poor flesh with whipping. Come, kind death, and bring relief. Anonymous abolitionist.
What I think about as a woman is the humiliation of it. I think about those women to whom cleanliness was such an integral part of their being, to be subjected to the filth and the dirt, to have to lie in their own feces, you know, to live amidst blood and vomit.
Disease was a relentless killer. Dysentery, smallpox, measles, and scurvy consumed the ships.
The floor of their rooms was so covered with blood and mucus that it resembled a slaughterhouse. Alexander Falconbridge, slave ship surgeon.
If indeed someone got sick with smallpox, which was incurable at the time, you simply tossed the person over. And if you suspected that it spread to others, you tossed these people over.
Abundance of these poor creatures are lost on board ships merely through the surgeon's ignorance, because he knows not what they are afflicted with, but supposing it to be a fever, bleeds and purges or vomits them, and so casts them into an incurable diarrhea. And in a few days, they become a feast for some hungry shark. Dr. T. Aubrey, slave ship surgeon.
During the Atlantic slave trade, the population and migratory practices of the Atlantic sharks changed dramatically. Sharks followed the slave ships for hundreds of miles across the Atlantic and the Caribbean.
Wednesday, June 12th, buried a man slave, number 84, of flux, which he'd been struggling with near 7 weeks. Thursday, June 13th, this morning buried a woman slave, number 47. Know not what to say she died of. She'd not been properly alive since she first came on board. Monday, June 24th, buried a slave boy, number 158, and a girl, number 172. Captain John Wheaton's logbook.
The exact number of Africans captured and delivered to the New World will probably never be known. It has been estimated that 15 million Africans began the journey to the United States, South America, and the Caribbean, and of those, at least 2 out of every 10 died at sea.
December. By the favor of divine providence, made a timely discovery today that the slaves were forming a plot for insurrection. Surprised two of them attempting to get off their irons, and in their rooms found knives, stones, shot, etc., and a cold chisel. There appeared 8 principally concerned in protecting the mischief, and 4 boys in supplying them with the above instruments. Put the boys in irons and slightly in the thumbscrews to urge them to a full confession. Captain John Newton.
We stood in arms, firing on the revolted slaves, of whom we killed some and wounded many. And many of the most mutinous leapt overboard and drowned themselves in the ocean with much resolution. James Barbo, English sailor, 1701.
Resistance, insurrection, rebellion, revolt. The enslaved Africans of the Middle Passage were desperate to be free.
The resistance begins at capture, wherever. Let's say in a Mende village. It continues down to the port, where they have to be carefully guarded to get to the port. Continues on to the ship, where they are chained. It continues in the Middle Passage, as we've seen, and then it goes right on to the sail in the New World.
Come on.
People going home. I am going too, to find my mother and my father. I am not afraid. I am going now. Now!
The most powerful resistance was revolt. There are over 300 documented accounts of slave ship uprisings.
The writings of slave traders and their logs and so forth record many mutinies, they call them. I think they were very frequent, particularly while they were still inside of Africa, when they thought they could get back home.
The organized African captives had pieces of iron they had torn off our door, as having premeditated a revolt. Thus armed, they fell on our men, upon the decks, unawares, and stabbed one of the stoutest of us all, Don Carlos, slave ship captain.
The idea of the chaining was to prevent mutinies. And of course, these were likely occurrences. The desire to be free was so strong that people wanted to mutiny the least opportunity that they got.
On July 1st, 1839, perhaps the most significant African revolt took place on the Spanish slave ship La Amistad. Singbe Pie, later known by his Spanish name Joseph Sinkay, led 53 Africans in a rebellion.
The spur for the mutiny came when Joseph Sinkay was talking to the mulatto cook on board the Amistad by sign language, what is going to happen to us. And Celestino, the cook, in a cruel jest, responded that they were going to cut them up and boil them and then eat them as dried meat. And Sinkay, needless to say, made up his mind, apparently at that point, that this is not going to happen to me and this is not going to happen to our people below.
Sinkay frantically looked for something that could help him escape. That something turned out to be a single nail.
Now the problem was to find weapons. And they broke open boxes below, and lo and behold, they found, of all things, sugarcane knives. And they armed themselves, and that evening, in the midst of a storm, they took over the vessel.
Between 3 and 4, I was awakened by a noise which was caused by blows given to the mulatto cook. I went on the deck and they attacked me. I seized a stick and a knife to defend myself. At this time, the prisoner wounded me on the head severely with one of the sugar knives. Pedro Montes, Spanish slaver.
They spared the life of the two slaveholders. Montes was a former ship's master, and they had seen him steer the ship, so they knew he knew how to do this, and they wanted to go back to Africa. They did not know how to navigate, so they instructed Montes to sail toward the rising sun. They knew that they had come from the rising sun, and if they went back that way, they would go to Africa. But at night, Montes would turn northwesterly, hoping to reach the United States. They followed this zigzag course for 2 months, and eventually in late August of 1839, they end up off the coast of Long Island.
They were imprisoned in New Haven, Connecticut, and charged with murder and piracy. It would be 2 years before their fate would ultimately be determined. When the case went to trial, the United States Circuit Court ruled that the Africans could not be tried for acts committed on a Spanish vessel on Spanish waters. However, under the mounting pressure to keep the Southern vote during the 1840 election, President Martin Van Buren immediately ordered an appeal of the decision. It would now be argued before the Supreme Court.
These Africans were up against power. They were up against the President of the United States and the Queen of Spain.
On March 9, 1841, at the age of 73, former President John Quincy Adams argued before the Supreme Court in support of Sin K and the Amistad Africans. John Quincy Adams had shown a great interest in the case from its very beginning.
He hadn't been in a courtroom for over three decades, but this man believed in the cause. He saw that he had a chance to do something before he died that would be of a great service to humanity.
After passionately arguing 8.5 hours before the Supreme Court, the decision was upheld. The Africans were freed and allowed to return to their homeland.
One looks at the decision that was made by Justice Joseph Story. What he decided was that the blacks indeed were kidnapped Africans. What Story was talking about was the inherent right of self-defense, that if you're kidnapped, whatever color you are, wherever you're from, you have the right to escape your captor. Indeed, you have the right to kill your captor if you're held against your own will. And so by the eternal principles of justice, these kidnapped Africans had the right to mutiny, to kill their captors, and get away in any fashion that they chose. And this is the only time in recorded history that you had people who were kidnapped in Africa, brought to the New World, and actually returned to their homes.
The legacy of Sin K is the indomitable will and the courage on the part of a human being to pursue his own destiny and to claim his right to be free, and that he cannot be dominated, should not be dominated by another human being.
Revolts like the Amistad did little to slow the Middle Passage. After 2 months and 3,000 miles, millions of African captives arrived in places like New Orleans, Louisiana, Charleston, South Carolina, and Savannah, Georgia. Slave ships continued to pour into the New World, bringing the Africans to market.
I was now more persuaded than ever that I was in another world. We did not know what to think of this as the vessel drew nearer. We plainly saw the harbor, many merchants and planters now come on board. They put us in separate parcels and examined us attentively. They also made us jump and pointed to the land, signifying we were to go there. Olauda Equiano, former African captive.
Even if they survived, once they got to the point of destination, you have the whole thing over again. The humiliation of being stripped down, of being hosed down, of being oiled and now fed for another inspection and for sale again, over and over again.
At length, the vendor master, who was to offer us for sale like a sheep or a cattle, arrived and asked my mother, which was the eldest. She said nothing, but pointed to me. He took me by the hand and led me out into the middle of the street and turned me slowly around, exposing me to the vendor, Mary Prince, former African captive.
I just can't imagine what it must have been like for a woman or a girl, child, being reduced to somebody who has no control over her own destiny. It's an intolerable, it's an unbearable thought. It's just unbearable.
The survivors of this grueling ordeal were sold on ships, on the auction block, or in slave markets.
They were taken into a slave market. A buyer would come in, say that they wanted so many Africans as slaves. They were showed to them nude. They felt their bodies, they looked at their teeth, they looked at their hair.
The brokers are so cunning that they shave them all close before we see them, so we can see no gray hairs in their heads or beards. And having liquored them well and sleeked with palm oil, 'tis no easy matter to know an old one from a middle-aged one. Thomas Phillips' slave ship captain.
Another method of selling slaves was called the scramble. Up to 1,500 African captives were confined to a pen. Buyers rushed in all at once, grabbed who they wanted, and took their pick to their corner of the pen, just as farmers had done when selecting livestock. The term, to corner the market, was originally meant for animals, but now included Africans. The price of slaves fluctuated. In 1754, George Washington bought a male slave for $260. When he went to the market 10 years later, he paid $285. Slaves were sold for small down payments and on reasonable terms. There was also a mail order business. By the mid-19th century, the top price paid for healthy slaves exceeded $2,000.
I own I am shocked at the purchase of slaves, and fear those who buy them and sell them are knaves. What I hear of their hardships, their tortures and groans, is almost enough to draw pity from stones. I pity them greatly, but I must be mum, for how could we do without sugar and rum? William Cooper, 18th century poet.
The slavers, they knew at one level that these were human beings, because they were obviously, clearly human beings. At the same time, they were objects of profit. And those two concepts couldn't obviously be really reconciled, and they never were reconciled. It was just, I think, that the sense of the humanity of these people was simply suppressed for the sake of gold. And the shocking thing is that human beings are able indefinitely to suppress the urgings of their common humanity and to deny it for the sake of making profits.
Is not the slave trade entirely a war with the heart of man? And surely, that which is begun by breaking down the barriers of virtue involves in its continuance destruction to every principle and buries all sentiment in ruin. O lauda equiano.
The Middle Passage ended for Equiano on the island of Barbados, one of the most profitable colonies in the British Empire. On Barbados, it was calculated that it was cheaper to work slaves to death and replace them with new slaves than to treat them humanely. Within 3 years of arrival, one out of three slaves would die. The boy Equiano, judged too small to cut sugarcane, was shipped north to the mainland of British America. On the mainland, the plantation system of Barbados was admired and imitated, particularly on the Carolina coast.
South Carolina started as the colony of a colony. Barbados had become overpopulated with the younger sons of English merchants and with their slaves. And in both cases, they began to look around, cast around for new places. And within the first decade after South Carolina's initial settlement, there were just loads of immigrants from Barbados who brought with them slaves from Barbados. But more important than just bringing slaves, unlike Virginia, they brought a fully conceived idea of slavery.
The Atlantic slave trade accelerated the development of colonial America. Africans brought advanced farming techniques such as complex irrigation systems that made the cultivation of crops possible. The goods produced by slave labor contributed to set a high standard of living for Europeans and Americans. Tobacco, sugar, cotton, all became the foundation of a growing world economy driven by forced slave labor.
Racial slavery turns out to be extraordinarily profitable for the people who have seized control. The planter can complain in his diary that it's been a bad year, or the crop is weak, or the rainy season lasted too long, but year in and year out, tremendous profits are being made.
The immigrants from Barbados had searched for a cash crop that would make them rich. Families like the Middletons found it. It was rice. The most prized Africans in Carolina were from Angola, Senegambia, and the Windward Coast, people who brought the rice-growing skills the Europeans did not have.
Rice is the most unhealthy work in which the slaves were employed, and they sank under it in great numbers. The causes of this dreadful mortality are the constant moisture and heat of the atmosphere, together with the alternate floodings and drying of the fields in which the Negroes are perpetually at work, often ankle deep in mud, with their bare heads exposed to the fierce rays of the sun. Captain Basil Hall.
Many masters can't be persuaded that Negroes and Indians are otherwise than beasts and use them like such. I daily perceive that many things are done here out of a worldly principle, little for God's sake. Francis Lejeu, Anglican minister.
In 1710, just 15 years after rice took hold in Carolina, Africans began to outnumber Europeans in the colony. As the number of Africans rose, so too did white fear and retaliation.
Mr. D told me once he cut off a Negro man's leg for running away. I asked him if the man had died in the operation, and how he, as a Christian, could answer for the horrid act before God. And he told me, answering was a thing of another world. What he thought and did were policy. He then said his scheme had the desired effect. It cured that man and some others of running away. Olada Equiano.
If you're a white authority, you're constantly trying to figure how tightly you want to impose the lid with respect to people running away. How fierce should the punishments be? You know, should it be a whipping? Should it be the loss of a finger or a hand or a foot? You know, should it be wearing shackles perpetually? The entire system of control is based on physical punishment, often making examples out of people so that others will be intimidated.
The colonial legislature passed laws designed to more tightly control the growing black majority. Planter records reveal punishments inflicted for infractions, large and small.
8th February 1709. I rose at 5 o'clock this morning and then read a chapter in Hebrew and 200 verses in Homer's Odyssey. I ate milk for breakfast. I said my prayers. Jenny and Eugene were whipped. 17 April. Annika was whipped yesterday for stealing the rum and filling the bottle up with water. I said my prayers and I danced my dance. Eugene was whipped again for pissing in bed, and Jenny for concealing it. I took a walk about the plantation. Eugene was whipped for running away and had the bit put on him. I said my prayers. I had good health, good thoughts, and good humor. Thanks be to God Almighty. William Byrd, Virginia Planter.
The point, I think, needs to be made very strongly that they were African people. They brought with them their language, they brought with them their history, they brought with them a sense of awareness of their culture.
The slave trade lasted throughout the world until the 19th century. By 1807, Britain declared the slave trade illegal. 1 year later, the United States followed suit. But the slave trade was far from over. Illegal ships were painted black and traveled under the cover of night, landing in Brazil, the Caribbean, Cuba, and the American Eastern Seaboard.
It was outlawed in 1808. But slaves continued to be smuggled into the United States down to 1862.
And it's very interesting that you can look at the advertisements of runaway slaves in the 1830s and 40s, and some of the advertisements will say, this person speaks Arabic. The person who had run away speaks Arabic, or he speaks French, or he speaks an African language, which means that in all probability they had not been in the country a full generation. The point is that these slaves were still being smuggled in, and the Middle Passage goes on.
It is believed that the last slave ship from Africa set its sail for Brazil in 1888, 20 years after Abraham Lincoln signed the Emancipation Proclamation, abolishing slavery in America.
The stain of slavery in this modern world is irrevocable. I think it is stamped so deeply into our psyche, not only in the American place, but the world over, because the human dynamic everywhere in the world is about power.
The Middle Passage symbolizes one of the most horrendous episodes in African and African diaspora history. And I suppose in the final analysis, this is what ultimately binds black people or people of African descent outside of Africa. It is a consciousness of a place of origin, but it's also a consciousness of a social condition.
In terms of trying to get a lesson across, one is trying to get people to see how it diminished us all.
The Middle Passage is like having a dirty secret in your closet. Nobody wants to admit that we treated America and Europe and Portugal, that we treated those people that way. That's where the Middle Passage came from. They could do it, and they did. And nobody wants to remember. It's the dirty secret.
Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. Sometimes
I did not know what to think of the strange new world. One by one, the faces I remembered from below disappeared, taken in different directions. Now I had only one friend, death. I wished he would come and take me. Fala, Fala, let me be accepted in a blanket in heaven. I waited and waited, but my wish did not come true. Finally, I turned to face the strange new world, no longer afraid of the raging water filled with human bones. The power from the water, promised by my father, ran through my veins. I became determined to live and sing my father's name forever.
I hope this journey will inspire you to look deeper into your history. Keep looking, keep searching. Knowledge is power. I'm Debbie Allen.